Now we're in part 3, acid-base balance. We're going to mainly talk about these two systems. Your respiratory system, your renal system. How they regulate your body pH balance. Your body pH needs to be well maintained. Your blood pH is around 7.4. And your body can be a little bit acidic, a little bit basic. But most of the time, your body is in an acidic situation. So most of the time, your body is fighting the acidic situation. The reason is you have a lot of input of acid. You eat meat, fatty acid, amino acid, and you breathe. You produce CO2. It becomes carbonic acid. And also your muscle exercise, you have the lactic acid, ketone acid. So your body have a lot of acid input. So all of this, most situation your body is fighting the acidosis situation. Your first weapon, buffer. Your blood is a buffer. So your blood will help you to maintain your plasma pH around 7.4. And if this one is not enough, your ventilation, your respiratory system will kick in. This is a quick on, quick off system. When you start to exercise, your CO2 level increase. The next second, your breathing rate increase. So this is very quick. And one, two, if these two are still not enough, you kick in another one. That's the renal system. But renal system is slow. Slow on, slow off. So renal system take a while to kick in. Usually days. So we think about after 24 hours, this one will kick in. So why acid-base balance is important? Because your body, all your body are made of protein, so it can denature your protein. And that's why your body pH needs to be well maintained. And if when your body becomes too acidic, can have hypoexcitability, and alkalosis, can have hyper, can have the muscle tenderness. So eventually you want to maintain your body pH in around 7.4 in the plasma, or the ICF should be around 7.2. And let's look at your first weapon to fight the pH. That's the buffer. And your blood is the buffer. And the buffer, we use the carbonic acid. So when we talk about the ventilation, the CO2, this is molecule can easily dissolve in water compared with oxygen. So it will dissolve in water. And when it be carried by blood, it can dissolve in water, plasma part. It can also be carried by red blood cell. And when it be carried by red blood cell, the red blood cell is going to turn the CO2 into carbonic acid and become bicarbonate and hydrogen. They can release the bicarb into your plasma. So you have a lot of bicarb in the plasma. And this makes your blood a buffer. If you have too much H+, you will bind with this, go back to carbonic acid, or even go back to become CO2. So your blood pH is well maintained because you have a lot of bicarbonate in your blood. And when you go to the lung, okay, you will come back, become a CO2, you exhale CO2 out. So that's your first weapon, that's your plasma. Your blood is a buffer. And that's this equation. So when the CO2 dissolves in water, become carbonic acid. And the carbonic acid can dissociate, become the hydrogen and bicarb. So they maintain the normal ratio. And because carbonic acid is a weak acid, so it can go in both directions. When you have too much hydrogen, it will go to the left. And when your body is too basic, it can go to the right, produce hydrogen. So this helps you to maintain your body pH. If the buffer system is not good enough, you go to the gym, you exercise, you found your breathing rate start to increase. So that's your second weapon to fight with your body pH, your respiratory system. And we talk about this in your respiratory system. You have the peripheral receptor in your where your baroreceptor is located. You also have the central receptor. Central receptor only detects CO2. Peripheral can detect the pH, hydrogen, and CO2. You will go to your RCC in your pons, medulla, oblongata, both of them, ask your muscle, skeletal muscle increase their ventilation. So your breathing rate increase, quickly decrease CO2. And this is a very quick system. That's when you start to exercise. Your next second, your breathing rate increase. So this is a quick on, quick off system. So your respiratory system, they are very good. They can use the hyperventilation or hypoventilation to fix your body pH. It can correct to about 75% of the problem. But if this person has chronic lung disease, he has respiratory problem, the respiratory system could not fix it. And that goes to our third system, renal system. This is slow response. So say this person has the chronic lung disease, we talk about a lot of them in the respiratory, in chapter 18, like this person have fibrotic lung disease, or have the emphysema, have all kind of lung disease to compromise their body to get oxygen. And you're gonna measure their urine, gonna find their urine gonna be very acidic. That's because this system kick in. So this system is a slow system, slow on, slow off. But once this system kick in, it's usually very good at maintain your body pH. So eventually, if this person's use the first weapon, the second weapon is still not working, this system kick in, like in those people with chronic lung disease, their urine is very acidic, but their blood pH still amazingly maintained around 7.4. So let's see how this system works. Overall, this is a picture. If it releases secrete hydrogen, it needs to reabsorb bicarb. And if you secrete bicarb and end up with reabsorbed hydrogen, so that's in acidosis situation, this alkalosis situation. And let's see why. This is molecular label, molecular mechanism, that's the overview. So it will turn CO2 into carbonic acid and become the hydrogen and bicarbonate. So hydrogen will be secreted to the urine, so urine will be very acidic. And you have ammonia in the urine to neutralize your acid. So urine have ammonia. In your elementary school, your science teacher may teach you, okay, you go camping and you'll be bitten by fire ant or wasp. Wasp and fire ant, they're actually cousins. And if you don't have ammonia, you can use your urine because your urine have ammonia. This can neutralize the acid. And you end up with reabsorbed bicarbonate. And that's important because bicarbonate can work as a buffer in your blood. So that's the overall picture. And in the proximal tubule, that's what happens. How they secrete hydrogen and reabsorb bicarb. So on the apical side, they use the sodium hydrogen exchanger. So they will take sodium back, secrete hydrogen. On the basal lateral side, they use the sodium bicarb symporter. So they will take sodium back, take bicarb back. So that's on the apical side. That's the areas with no regulation. So they will keep doing this. They will take bicarb back, secrete hydrogen. Then let's look at the distal part. The distal nephron, that's the place, can be regulated based on your body need. When we talk about the water reabsorption, and that's the area vessel pressing work to take more or less water back based on your body need. For the acid basic situation, the same. That's the area they can change based on your body need. If your body is too acidic, say this person has chronic lung disease and their respiratory system been compromised and their breathing rate is slower, their body is short of oxygen, your body have too much CO2, your body is acidic, that's what happened. In the distal nephron, and they use the type A intercalated cells. And what happens is on the apical side, they put the hydrogen potassium ATPase. That's why acid base balance also associated with your potassium balance in your body, because they use the hydrogen potassium ATPase. They're gonna pump hydrogen out. So you use ATP as energy source, primary active transport, pump hydrogen out, it will take potassium back. And that's why usually people with chronic acidosis, their body is hyperkalemia, their body's potassium level is high. And on the basolateral side, okay, they will take the bicarb back and move the chloride. If the body is too basic, they basically just swap these two. You found they just put the hydrogen potassium ATPase on the basolateral side and the other one on the apical side. They just swap these two. So this type B intercalated cell. And it turned out type A and type B intercalated cells, they're actually the same kind of cells. And these cells can move those membrane proteins from one side to the other based on your body need. And to move the membrane protein back to put on the other side take a while. That's why this system is a slow system. We usually consider this system kick in after 24 hours. So after days, we start to consider this system. And if the patients got pH out of balance in 30 minutes, in 1 hour, we know this system, the renal system, haven't kicked in yet. So because of these three weapons you have, your body pH is well maintained in a very small range. If you go a little bit higher, it's alkalosis. If it goes a little bit lower, that's acidosis. And if you go out of this range, there's actually the patient is dead already. So you can have metabolic acidosis, respiratory acidosis, metabolic alkalosis, respiratory alkalosis. And if the person have the respiratory problem, the beginning point is CO2. This is a starting point. And if this person's pH out of balance due to metabolic, it begins with hydrogen. Say he vomit, he has food poisoning, he vomit a lot, he will throw out a lot of H+. And your body will gonna have a compensation. If it's respiratory compensation, it's quick. If it's renal compensation, it will be slow. And we will do more practice of this in your last discussion exercise. Here I just use one example. Say if this person has metabolic acidosis, he has diarrhea, he loses bicarb. So his metabolic acidosis, and also while he vomit, say he has diarrhea, he loses bicarb. His body H+ is too high. So that's what happens. Or ketone acidosis happens in type A diabetes patients. So you have too much hydrogen. What happens is this equation, it will go to the left and it will remove some of the hydrogen to produce CO2. So eventually his CO2 level is high, his hydrogen level is high, his bicarb is low. So in the hospital, if we test this person's CO2 level, hydrogen level, bicarb level, that's what we found. We found the CO2 is high, hydrogen is higher than normal, and bicarb is lower than normal. So we, based on these three data, we know this person is metabolic acidosis. And sometimes we find the compensation, especially the respiratory compensation is quick. So it can fix the CO2. So we may find the situation, this person, okay, well, his CO2 level is normal. But it's still, this type won't lie to you, these two won't lie to you. Its hydrogen level is still higher than normal, bicarb is still lower than normal. And we, based on this, we know this person is still metabolic acidosis. And its compensation is, if it has renal compensation, it will be the type A cells kick in to compensate it. And we will do more practice in the last discussion exercise. Okay, that's it.